So Alabama wins the toss. They deferred, so they just actually decided to take the football, and Kentucky will kick it off in the corner. Here comes the tag. Javier Arenas to the 20. Arenas to the 40. And pushed out of bounds at the 38-yard line. 51 yards on the return. It was Travard Lindley that ran him out of bounds.
Well, we talked about it. Running the football, defense, and certainly special teams. And right here, Javier Arenas, he's going to give him a chance every week to have great field position. Came in averaging 28 yards per return. He is fantastic as a returner.
So Alabama with outstanding field position to open up this game inside the Kentucky 40, first down and 10. And we talked about the ability of Kentucky to get off to a good start today. Well, defense already with their backs against the wall. And the pistol formation, McElroy. Pass incomplete. Could have been picked off. Micah Johnson had a chance to pick it off his shoelaces. Didn't work. Greg McElroy. What can you say about this young man, the junior out of South Lake, Texas? Andre, he has been better than I think anybody expected, and they thought he was going to be good.
Yeah, originally committed to
After
Texas
the play
Tech.
Was over, personal foul on the defense, number 55. The penalty is 15 yards. Automatic first down.
Well, you don't need any help. You need to help Alabama with unsportsmanlike penalties there, and Daquan Evans, the right defensive end for Kentucky, with a little bit of a late hit, and it's going to cost them 15 yards and basically set Alabama up inside the red zone.
DeQuinn Evans, the junior college transfer, with that 15-yard penalty. Alabama moves to the 18-yard line. Here's McElroy, and off left side, Mark Ingram. Give him about six on the carry. Alabama starting lineup offensively coming up above our score. There is Mark Ingram. Not only is he leading this team in rushing, but he's also leading the team in receptions. 225 touches now without losing a fumble. Did drop one against LSU, but his club was able to pick it up. But he has not lost a fumble in 225 touches. Ingram busted to the outside. He will walk it into the end zone. 57 seconds into the game, the Tide score a touchdown.
Boy, they do a great job on the right side of that offensive line of collapsing things down inside. They show it going left, and they're going to bring Mark Ingram back to the right side of the formation. You'll see it here. Start to the left. Now cut it all the way back. Now it's just one guy to make miss. And Randall Burton, the sophomore corner, a little bit late.
Going after up and good by Lee Tiffin. The flag is down at the 10-yard line. Roughing the kicker against Kentucky. They will assess it on the kickoff. Point after will be good. Ken Williamson lost his microphone, but we do know that it was against Kentucky. Alabama. This is what they do, folks. They run it right at you, and they're very good at it. There's Mark Ingram, the man of the moment for this Alabama team with the 11-yard touchdown drive to give Alabama the 7-0 lead. It only took 57 minutes. Of course, it was all set up by the excellent return of Javier Arenas.
Well, they didn't waste any time getting the deal done. 57 seconds into the first quarter, and here we are with Alabama leading already.
After the penalty was assessed, a short kickoff, short field for Alabama, and Kentucky will bring it out to the 20-yard line. Let's go back to that touchdown.
We'll take a look at it. They formation you. They're going to bring Marquise Mays into the slot right here. They've got leverage with a tight end on the outside. And so they formation, you force you to bump everybody over. They start the run to the left. And now right here, you got one-on-one with Mark Ingram and the defender, Randall Burton. He makes a miss, and it's a walk into the end zone. Alabama sound in the running game.
Kentucky will try to get their running game going. A flag down the near side, right around the 20-yard line.
Eric Block, the Kentucky ball carrier.
Ken Williamson, already a busy man here in Lexington. Well, Kentucky will get a free 5 yards out of this. Well, Mike Hartline is the starter, the junior out of Canton, Ohio. Started the year last year. It's kind of a roller coaster season for the young man, but it's his show now, Andre. And talking to him yesterday, he seemed like he has some of that swagger back.
Yeah, he has really stepped up as a leader on this football team, and the coaching staff really needed that from the quarterback position.
Hand off right side. Derek Locke will take it out over the 30. That'll be a first down. Give him 6 on the carry. Javier Arenas with the tackle.
Here they go with Derek Locke. Alfonso Smith, we'll see him at the tailback position as well. And around these parts, they refer to it as Locksmith. Derek Locke and Alfonso Smith.
Kentucky quickly to the line, first down and 10. They'll run the play. This time Locke hit, might have lost a yard. Brandon Dederick with the tackle. Brandon getting his first start of the season today. Of course, many of you know the story, was shot 5 days before the season over against Virginia Tech. Somebody tried to rob him in a parking lot. He got shot through the arm. It went into his upper leg area, came back and played a few snaps against Virginia Tech, and has worked his way, finally getting his first start of the season. Hartline. Quick hitter to the outside, goes to the fullback, John Connor. He'll get a couple on the play. That'll bring up third down.
Well, with a defense like Alabama's, John Connor there would have been better served to just continue to the outside. You stop and try to turn back, make one guy miss you. Guess what? Two more of those Crimson Tide helmets are going to show up. John Connor, one of the better fullbacks in the SEC, known as the best blocking fullback in this conference.
Third down and long. We'll say third down and 8 yards. Out of the shotgun, Hartline. Hartline, nowhere to go. Throws it back over the middle. It's picked off. Mark Barron picks it off at the 40-yard line. Alabama will have the football. The second interception of the year.
You know what? This is a lesson right here. When we replay this one, every young quarterback in the country, if you have your eyes on this football game, this is an absolute no-no. You get flushed out of the pocket. There's nowhere to go with the football. Now, you're flushed out. Throw it away or just run it. You do not roll to your right and throw back across the middle. Don't do it.
Yeah, no gray area there.
None. I mean, don't do it. If you don't hear it in my voice, you know how serious it is.
Julio Jones down the right side. No flag on the play. There was some contact. Javard Lindley on the coverage. That's the matchup we highlighted earlier today.
And a lot of coaches like to do that, Dave. They get a big turnover like that on your opponent's side of the 50-yard line. Hey, they're going up top to take a shot to one of the better receivers in the country. And you see Greg McElroy right here. He gets the one-on-one coverage with Julio Jones that he wants. But guess who's there? Javard Lindley, and he will be in his hip pocket for most of this football game.
Second down and 10. Alabama out of that pistol formation. Hand off to Ingram off the left side. Gets it down to the 30. Actually gets it to the 33-yard line. Let's take a look at today's Principal Financial Group edge to the game.
Stopped by Guy and Trevathan.
Well, you look at it, the keys for Alabama, they've got established dominance up front. They're up to a good start, it seems, though, in the first quarter of this game. And Kentucky got to be gap sound. We talked about it. You saw one player get out of his gap, and it cost him an 11-yard touchdown run by Mark Ingram.
Third down and 5. McElroy hit as he throws, lofts it up. Looking for Mays. Did he make the catch out of bounds?
Well, that one may have been forced by Corey Peters, the right defensive tackle. for Kentucky got right in the face of Greg McElroy, which didn't allow him the ability to really step into this throw. And right here, Marquise Mays clearly out of bounds. The officials make a great call. Good grab, though. I think that one was timed just well by Corey Peters.
DJ Fitzgerald in punt formation.
What big turnover, and you hold defensively. Great job by Kentucky.
That was big in a lot of ways. DJ Fitzgerald fielded by Randall Cobb. Takes that over the 30. How about Cobb with a heads up play? A lot of guys just thought it would hit the ground, and Cobb came up and made a play.
The man likes the football in his hands, and it was kind of one of those punts where you try to knock it down inside the 10-yard line. Left it a little short, and Randall Cobb kind of takes things over. Alabama leading this one early, 7-0.
And welcome back to our Wrangler SEC Game of the Week as the Kentucky Wildcat basketball team just moments ago came onto the field. There's Coach Calipari, gimpy knees and all, making his way out to a rousing ovation. These folks are ready for some basketball. That'd be an understatement.
He is the man in this town all of a sudden. A lot of high expectations for this Kentucky Wildcat basketball team this season.
Randall Cobb in at quarterback. Into the Wildcat formation, he will keep it off the left side. We expect to see that maybe a little bit more today. They just think they have to get the football in his hands.
Well, I counted about six different positions or ways they could get him the football. Out wide at wide receiver, move him into the slot, that's two. Running back, quarterback, and then both returns, punt returns and kickoff returns. They like to get him about 12 to 15 touches throughout a ball game.
Well, two touches so far, one on a punt return, and then the rush off the left side just moments ago. Second down and six. Hartline throws it near center. Pass is caught. Chris Matthews, young man at a junior college. They say the ceiling is very high for this person. Coming in from junior college, he's had some mishaps in terms of understanding the plays, Andre, but they really like his ability.
Yeah, a couple of mental breakdowns, but he was a JC All-American last season at L.A. Harbor College, where he caught, had 80 receptions, over 1,200 yards, and 11 touchdowns. That'll get you some All-American honors.
Yes. And off left side. Here goes Derek Locke, the junior out of Hugo, Oklahoma, brought down by Corey Reamer. Thank you very much, Rob. A lot of people keeping an eye on that game as Randall Cobb back in the game. We'll take the snap. Gets it inside the 45, and that will be a Wildcat first down. Of course, in the SEC, there are three teams in the top four. One of those right here on the field wearing white. Randall Cobb back in the quarterback again. This time he hands it off to Derek Locke, and he gets tripped up in the backfield by the safety, Justin Woodall. Heck of a play from Woodall.
Well, they've shown that they'll run Randall Cobb once he shows the play fake. But watch Justin Woodall come up from the free safety position and lay a hat on you. That's what you got to have when teams decide to go option or that Wildcat formation. Good, sound tackling from the secondary.
Woodall, the senior at Oxford, Mississippi. Second down and long. Second and 17. Hartline to Locke. Makes a man miss. Locke to the 40. He may have picked up the first down inside the 35. I think he did. He'll spot it at about the 34-and-a-half-yard line. Time for us to take a look at our impact players brought to you by Hampton Inn. At Hampton, we love having you here.
Yeah, and for Kentucky, it's Mike Hartline, the quarterback. You talked about the leadership skills. Eighth in the SEC in passing yards, Randall Cobb. They'll get it to him any way they can. And Trevard Lindley, he'll have the tough task of checking Julio Jones all afternoon, a second-team All-American at corner for Kentucky.
Alfonso Smith and it running back. Trying to swing it out to the fullback, John Connor. It's incomplete. Pressure came up, forced Hartline to get rid of it quicker. Rolando McClain.
I think he learned a lesson on that other pass.
Yes.
That he threw for an interception. You get pressure, there's nowhere to go with the football. The shoelaces of one of your receivers is a nice place to get rid of the football.
Rolando McClain going about his business without his running mate, Dante Hightower. Out for the rest of the year after blowing out his knee last week in the first quarter. Here's Derek Locke, nowhere to go. A man that's going to have to step up his game in the absence of Hightower. Corey Reamer, one of the guys, makes the play.
Yeah, they'll do it with Corey Reamer. Eric Anders will drop over, put his hand on the ground, and then Courtney Upshaw will bump himself up to the old spot of Eric Anders. So they're going to do it by committee. That's how good Dante Hightower is. One guy can't just replace him as a player. It's going to take three guys kind of shuffling to do the job of Dante Hightower. That's what he meant to this Alabama defense.
Third down and a dozen.
Well, they've got one-on-one coverage up top.
Here goes Locke off the left side. That'll get him to the 30-yard line. Here comes the field goal unit.
They're trying to position. You wonder why. Why call a run in this situation? Third down and 10, awfully hard to convert against the second best defense in the entire country. But you know what? We can maintain field position and give ourselves a chance by running the football, give ourselves a chance to at least attempt a field goal.
49-yarder, Lonis Sieber. Career long, 48. Give him a new career long. Sieber from 49 yards out gives Kentucky 3 points here in the first quarter.
Boy, his season long before that kick, Dave, was just 26 yards and only attempted two field goals for the entire season. But he hit that baby like he knew what he was doing.
The senior out of San Antonio.
A lot of things go into it. The snap, the hold, that part of it's clean, and then you got to have the kicker give you a nice, clean pass at the football, and he does in that situation. Oh, Kentucky bringing himself, drawing ever so close to Alabama.
Rich Brooks said his club had to get off to a better start today. Nick Saban doesn't want to give up any points.
None. You know, they only allow 13 points a game defensively. So giving up three early, this early, is a little bit unusual for Coach Saban.
That's right, 36 yards, but it ate up 4.5 minutes off the clock.
I like it. Good mixture of run and pass and bringing Randall Cobb in for some Wildcat stuff to basically add an element of speed to the offense. And Kentucky finds themselves right back in this thing.
How big was the three and out, the defense forced
huge
by Kentucky a little while ago?
It was huge because of the momentum change. You're already trailing. If you get hit on one of those big passes, now you're looking at 10-0 or maybe 14-0 before you can bat an eye.
McIntosh will kick it off. Short kick, hits at the 15. Picked up by Terry Green. Big hit. Out over the 25-yard line. Matt Rowe on the special teams tackle. Alabama will take it at the 26-yard line. This offense averaging 40.5 points a game, third in the conference. Last year they averaged 30 points a contest, so a little bit more production out of this group. Julio Jones on a receiver screen out over the 30 to the 31. Played well by the Kentucky defense. Paul Wolford in on the tackle.
Nice job there. You don't want to let a receiver as dangerous as Julio get going.
Second down. And six. McElroy steps in the pocket, fires over the head of his intended target. That'll bring up third down.
It looked as though he was trying to go deep down the sideline to Terry Grant, a running back out of the backfield. And those guys aren't used to those deep passes. He pulled up and Greg McElroy went ahead and went down the field. Now it's third down and went about six, about medium. This is not where you start to panic if you're Alabama, but after going three and out in the previous drive, might be a little bit concerned.
Boy, Jones bouncing all over the line of scrimmage. They go to him at the 40, and it's incomplete. The defense holds again. Well, McElroy came in completing 67% of his passes. He's off to a little bit of a slow start today.
Well, after a fast start, which they went right down the field, a Harvey Arenas kickoff return that set him up in point-blank range of a penalty to go along with it. Kentucky's really stepped up defensively with Coach Defensive Coordinator Steve Brown calling the defensive plays for them, and they're responding.
P.J. Fitzgerald back to punt. Kentucky, good rush. No flag. Here's Cobb to the 30. Cobb to the 40 and drops there, but a good return by Randall Cobb, the sophomore. And then a flag comes in late.
This one's going to be another unsportsmanlike, I think, on Kentucky. Late hit. And I'm not sure of the number, but it was on. The recipient is Brian Selman, this deep snapper for Alabama. He got hit late, and the officials were right there on top of it. A little block in the back.
Can't have that if you're Kentucky. That'll back them up 15 yards to the 31-yard line. Well, the last time that man was in this stadium, it was a shocking conclusion. We'll have those details when we come back. Back in Lexington, Kentucky on a gorgeous Saturday afternoon, Alabama scored in 53 seconds to open this game. Lead 7-3, first down and 10, Wildcats. Derek Locke, 6 carries, 6 yards before that run, and he'll have 7 carries for, let's just say, I was here, and I still can't believe what I saw.
And Rich Brooks would love to avoid any such resemblance to that play.
Ryan Morris, of course, the head coach of Kentucky at the time. That was the whole scenario of dumping the water jug on top of the coach.
Literally.
Yeah, and the fans stormed the field at one end while LSU celebrating at the other end. It was one of the greatest plays in the history of this conference, which goes back to 1933. So Nick Saban hadn't set foot in this stadium since that day until now. Third down and 7. This is what Joker Phillips wanted to stay away from. This time they're able to pick up the first down. Derek Locke will get it to the 42-yard line. First down, Kentucky.
Well, excellent play call. There's about 3 different blitzers coming from the left side of the formation with Rolando McClain. You count it, you name it. They're coming. Courtney Upshaw, but you call the run away from where the pressure's coming. I tell you what, you outnumber that side of the defense. Excellent job in picking up the first down.
Last week, Kentucky 0-for-11 on third downs and 7s and more. Randall Cobb in at quarterback makes a guy miss. Makes another man miss. Picks up the first down. Give Cobb a dozen on the carry. Mark Barron finally runs him out of bounds.
Boy, what a great block by Chris Matthews, the wide receiver. Smart getting off his guy so you don't get the holding penalty. And then peeling back and catching a guy coming in pursuit to free up Randall Cobb. Watch the top of your screen, number 8, right there. Watch it. Let him go. Don't hold him. But now I'm going to peel back and get me a defensive lineman.
I think that D lineman will remember Matthews.
I love it. Well, you know what? It'll be a long time before he catches him.
Here's Cobb again. Nothing happened on that play off guard. Lorenzo Washington, a senior out of Logansville, Georgia, brings him down.
Randall Cobb, we wanted to track just how many touches he had in this ball game. Mentioned it earlier, 12 to 15 is what the coaching staff will shoot for. Already 6 touches, 55 yards. You think he's going to have an effect on this ball game before day's end?
I guess Rich Brooks says, if we're going to go down, let's go down with our best player touching the football all day.
Always, my friend, always.
Alfonso Smith, first down, Kentucky. He's running hard. The senior out of Louisville, Kentucky. Tackled by Mark Barron. Already 4 stops for Barron from his strong safety position.
Well, I like to recognize guys when they throw nice blocks. And T.C. Drake, the big senior tight end, Brantstown, Kentucky threw a nice block for Alfonso Smith to free him up on the outside edge.
3:15 to go in the opening quarter. First and 10. Here's Smith again, bouncing around, gets it to the 30-yard line. Let's go downstairs once again, check in with Kara.
Well, guys, I'm on a hardwired microphone now. This should be more successful. Coach Brooks has watched tons of film the last few weeks on Florida and Alabama. We asked him who was the best. He said, defensively, you can flip a coin, but offensively, both teams run their schemes so well. The difference is that the Gators might be a little bit down in their receivers this year. Of course, Brooks, with a twinkle in his eye, then saying to us, we might all see that question answered in the title game December 5th.
Thank you, Kara.
Would not surprise me one bit to see Alabama and Florida playing in the SEC championship game once season ends. If both teams remain healthy, pretty good bet that that's who you might see. After watching LSU, they've still got some shortcomings offensively. Watch them last week in a ball game at Mississippi State. We were there.
Bulldogs should have won that one. There's no two ways about it.
And I thought LSU would be the team out of the West this year. I'm not afraid to admit that.
Hartline on third down. Hands it off. Fullback Connor. Excuse me, Montsell Allen, the junior out of New Orleans. He's not going to get the first down.
It's going to be close.
Yeah,
it's
going to be about a half yard shy, it appears. So fourth down coming up. Crowder obviously wants him to go for it.
Looks like he will, and they bring in the big heavies. Justin Jeffries, more of a run blocker at right tackle for Rich Brooks in this offensive unit than Brad Durham. So here we go.
Fullback Lee John Connor. First down, Kentucky.
He can carry it too, you know. He didn't just block all the time. Big guy was a walk-on, former walk-on, and now known as one of the best blocking backs in the SEC, nicknamed him the Terminator. I guess you know a little name play there, John Connor. But that was nice. He terminates guys on the defensive side of the ball, that's for sure.
Out of the I formation. Here's Locke. Giving about a yard on the play. He's a true fan. You see a lot of that around the SEC. Handoff, Derek Locke. Nothing happening off Locke goal.
And it got started with his grandfather Chuck, as you mentioned, and just kind of kept going on through the family. And now Ryan's a third generation quarterback here at Kentucky.
A couple of runs off tackle sets up another third and long. And this is, these are those downs that Joker Phillips says just make it so hard. Don't have a whole lot of plays drawn up for these third and long situations.
They're tough to convert against, especially against a defense like Alabama.
Pressure comes, Hartline drop back at the 33-yard line. Eric Anders, the senior out of San Antonio, Texas, now with 2.5 sacks on the year.
Boy, he is just so fast off the edge. He's just going to line up right there, and I'm going to beat my guy right around the left edge and zip dunk in the left tackle. He did the exact same thing last week against Arkansas and Ryan Mallett. He's the guy now that drops his hand down on the ground as a pass rusher now that Dante Hightower is out of that lineup.
Kentucky will take a timeout on fourth down coming up. Field goal unit out on the field. Well, celebrating its fifth year sponsoring the Good Hands Field Goal Nets, Allstate makes contributions to participating universities, general scholarship funds for each field goal and extra point kicked. Today, Allstate has contributed more than $1.8 million in scholarship monies.
Keep up the good work, Allstate.
Well, moments ago, Lona Sieber hit a career-long 49-yarder. This one looks like it'll be another 49-yarder, and I think that timeout was called, by the way. It's the end of the quarter, and the wind is at the back of Lona Sieber right now. It is a pretty substantial win, around 15, 20 miles an hour, so a heads-up play by Rich Brooks. Snaps good. Kicks on the way. Back-to-back 49-yarders for Lona Sieber.
No problem.
So the Kentucky Wildcats, after giving up 31 first quarter points to Florida last week, only trail by a single point after 15 minutes against the third ranked team in the country. All six of their points off the right foot of that man, Lona Siever. Second quarter action from Lexington around the corner. Gorgeous day, Memorial Hall here on the campus of the University of Kentucky. It's our SEC Network Game of the Week. Dave Neal, Andre Ware, Kara Capuano. Look at our storylines. Alabama's owned this series. Kentucky's not had a whole lot of success against ranked teams, but they've had a pretty good first quarter, trailing by one, 7-6. As we begin the second quarter, after the Lona Siever field goal, McIntosh will kick it off. Fielded by Terry Grant. Grant to the 25, dropped at the 30-yard line. Monsell Allen brings him down. There's Lona Siever, came in with a career long of 48 yards that he's hit three times in his career. Well, you can erase that because he has back-to-back 49-yarders this afternoon.
Man's consistent. Two 49-yarders and the two field goal drives. They've eaten up roughly about 10 minutes. So you look at the time of possession being dominated by Kentucky. 12 minutes compared to just three for this Alabama squad.
Here's Marquise Mays out to the 32-yard line. Well, it didn't take long, Andre, just 53 seconds for Alabama to get on the board.
Yeah, nice 11-yard touchdown run by Mark Ingram, and then the two 49-yard field goals. Lona Siever right here, the second, which draws this game to within 1 point. Got a good ball game going.
Connects, but Mike McCoy was just blown up by Winston Guy, the safety, the sophomore from right here in Lexington, just introduced himself to Mr. McCoy.
Let me tell you something. I went down to the field. I like to go down to the field, get the smell, you know, watch players as they warm up. And I stood next to Winston Guy. You talk about
holding on the offense on the 77. The penalty was 10 yards from the spot.
Well, you talk about just an impressive physical figure. Listen to this. Oh, yeah. He is a big-time guy. He brings it. Winston Guy, the free safety from Kentucky.
Well, the hold on James Carpenter will send Alabama back to the 23-yard line. Down and 17. Here's Ingram out to the 27-yard line. Let's take a look at our impact players brought to you by Hampton Inn. At Hampton, we love having you here.
Well, with Alabama, it all starts up front with a signal caller. Greg McElroy, 20-0 as a starter. That's dating back to both in high school and college. He's undefeated. Mark Ingram and Trent Richardson. Look at the yards per carry for Trent Richardson. 5.7 for Ingram. They provide the running punch for Nick Saban in that Alabama offense.
McElroy's numbers 1 out of 6 to start this game. Roy Upchurch in the backfield. McElroy will set up the screen to Upchurch, but Kentucky ready from the get-go.
Boy, it's as if Steve Brown has a Alabama playbook. And he's looking at formation, signaling in plays. Trevard Lindley, a guy we talked about at the top of this broadcast, making plays, second team All-American a year ago.
P.J. Fitzgerald will have to come in and punt on 4th down and 17. Randall Cobb stands at the 38-yard line. Fitzgerald with a good kick with the wind at his back. Cobb will field it at the 25. Look at Randall Cobb move around. 35-yard line. Brought down by Corey Reamer.
Right. Randall Cobb with his 7th touch, but McElroy right here finding it hard. Come on back with a 7-6 Kentucky.
And welcome back to the Wrangler SEC Game of the Week. Be sure to stay tuned to see which player selected as the Wrangler five-star player of this game. Right now, you got to think Lonis Sieber might be the guy with a couple of field goals. But a flag moments ago, Andre, on a personal foul against the Crimson Tide, moves Kentucky 15 yards closer. They're right up at midfield. Derek Locke will get a couple of yards and a 48. But after the kick, a 15-yard personal foul against Drake Kirkpatrick.
It's kind of been a messy game so far. Alabama, three penalties for 30 yards. Kentucky, three of their own for 45 yards. I think the bigger penalties that have played into this were on the first opening drive for Alabama, that 15-yard additional yard for personal foul. That led to the 11-yard touchdown run by Mark Ingram.
Since then, Alabama hasn't been able to do anything offensively. Another run off the right side, maybe a yard.
This is about par for the course here. I was talking to Joker Phillips yesterday in meetings. He said, you know, we'll take 2 yards on first down, come back, run the football, 2 yards on second down, where we get ourselves in third down and medium, and we can convert those situations. Guess where they are? Third down and six, third and medium.
One out of four on third downs today. Pass is caught to Cobb, but only gained about a yard. Cobb came all the way across the field. McClain with the stop for Alabama, and now the Wildcats will have to punt it away.
Mark Hartline, he's got to do a little bit better job of knowing and feeling the pressure. You get so locked on, and I ask him, third down, who do you like? Randall Cobb. You got so locked on to Cobb, you got to feel that I've got just a little bit more time to take my eyes to the second level of the pass route and beyond, where Randall Cobb's coming underneath in zone coverage, so that you give yourself at least a chance to pick up a first down.
Vidlotsky to punt it away. Arenas will let it hit at the five. Kentucky's all over it. They will pin Alabama inside the 5 yard line at the 4.
And guess what? No flag.
We got ourselves a 7-6 ball game here in Lexington. Stay with us on the SEC Network. Kentucky fans on their feet. Their club trails third-ranked Alabama by a single point. 10-17 to go here in the second quarter. A full house inside Commonwealth Stadium. Alabama backed up inside their five. They have had a tough time getting it cranked up. 12 plays, just 29 yards today. Trent Richardson, the true freshman, in at tailback. Flag down. I think Kentucky might have.
Well, it's usually a false start if they stop the play.
Yep.
So we're going to get about a half a distance to the goal line penalty here.
Prior to the snap, false start. The offense, 2-4. That's the difference for the goal. It remains first down.
Thought for a moment Kentucky might have drawn Alabama offsides, but it's all the Crimson Tide.
We talk about a fired up defensive unit, and rightfully so. After that opening drive, they have been just solid defensively. Kentucky.
Big hit at the line of scrimmage. No gain for Trent Richardson, but a flag down in the end zone. Corey Peters led the charge for the Wildcats.
That play happened so fast, I'm not quite sure what penalty would have been called. Kentucky players.
Illegal shift.
Pointing at the Alabama players.
Illegal shift on the offense. Number 8 was in motion and never did reset. The penalties declined. Second down.
Boy, the 60,000 on hand are about to make some serious noise as Alabama's backed up their own 2 yard line.
Dave, this is when home field advantage really kicks in. You're on the road as a quarterback just trying to call the cadence. You almost have to use hand signals
runs out of bounds at the 7-yard line, forced out of bounds by Micah Johnson. That is about 6 yards shy of the first down marker, and that'll bring up a third down situation.
Well, they do a good job. That's an excellent play call by Jim McElwain, the offensive coordinator, giving Greg McElroy the option to run or pass. And he gets the corner and just outruns Micah Johnson, his senior middle linebacker, just to give him enough room to work here on third down.
Alabama's yet to convert a third down today. They came in pretty good in the league, converting at a clip of 44%. Pass caught over the middle, but shy of the first down. Roy Upchurch makes the catch at the 12-yard line, but they needed to get to the 14. Danny Trevathan,
and they
tackle.
They go to their third down back, Upchurch. And keep an eye on Tavard Lindley and Julio Jones. We like this matchup, and they are locked on. Third down situation. They go a little bit zone, but you see him right there in the hip pocket of Julio Jones, the big-time receiver from Alabama. Boy, Kentucky playing solid defense.
Randall Cobb back at the 48. Fitzgerald, another good kick. Max Cobb up to the 35. Randall makes a man miss. To midfield and dropped there. A 14-yard return by Randall Cobb, brought down by Courtney Upshaw. Thank you very much, Rob. Hartline checking off of the line of scrimmage. Play clock, plenty of time. Kentucky's not shy about running it off guard today. As we take a look at AP top 10. And last week, Andre, I got to give you credit. You called it early and said there would be four or five upsets. And, well, there were four big upsets inside the top 10.
A little changing in the top 10, but you look, and what's impressive for the SEC, Florida, Alabama at number 3, Florida at the top. And you got LSU wedged in there at number 4. That's not bad. 3 teams in the top 5.
Thrown behind Cobb. Incomplete. That'll bring up third down. It's another one of those third down and tricky situations. 3rd and 7.
You know, quarterbacks, watch right here. Randall Cobb coming down inside in motion. He gets a natural pick from his tight end. But that ball's got to be thrown either into his body or out in front so that he can catch it on the move. Mike Hartline, to me, he seems like he's still got that adrenaline rush that all quarterbacks get before a football game. Hadn't quite settled in yet.
Good throw across the middle. A little bit low. Cobb can't hang on. That would have been good enough for a first down. Instead, it's fourth down, and here comes the punt team.
No harm done. You're within 1 point. Plenty of time. You'll get another, maybe a possession, maybe even two before the halftime. And your defense is playing well.
It's a field position battle.
No doubt about it. When it's this close, and we talked about it, being in the football game, giving yourself a chance to win in the second half. Well, this is right according to plan with what Rich Brooks wants to do.
Lotchka was a pooch punter a year ago. Got the full-time job this year. Now you know why he was the pooch punter. That's back-to-back kicks that have pinned Alabama inside the 5-yard line. Look at some of the Alabama faithful that have made their way to Lexington. 7-6 tied out in front. They're backed up inside the 5 again. Greg McElroy off to a slow start today. What's going on with Greg?
Well, you know, he really hadn't settled in either, but it's been field position in a lot of instances.
That could be a safety. They will say his forward progress.
I don't know about that. They got to take a look at this upstairs. They've got to take a look at this one.
At about the 1-inch line.
I don't think he got out of the end zone.
Micah Johnson with a big hit.
Big time hit from an all-SEC player of a year ago. But the officials, replay officials, need to take a look at this one. See tremendous penetration here by Kentucky, and then it's going to be. He did. He got it out of the end zone. Barely.
An excellent call. They're going to look at this, but our view.
They're showing a look on the replay. board here in the stadium. That's why you hear the fans, and it's not a good look.
Right.
Once the replay officials get the look we just showed you, then they'll see that he clearly got out of the end zone.
It's where your forward progress comes to a stop, and that football was clearly outside the goal line.
Well, you know, you can't stop and try to make a guy miss you. You got to continue going downhill right there. You're trying to make a guy miss, and that's a young freshman running back right there. He'll learn that lesson in film study from the coaches. But you got to continue on at all cost, no matter what or how the collision is going to take place, because that's too close. Take one more look and you'll see right there, just as he gets barely out of the end zone.
Look like our line judge, Michael Taylor.
Ferns.
That's a good call.
Our line judge, Michael Taylor, right on top of it. Good spot. Regardless, Alabama still only has about, they can't mess around. I mean, they're like an inch away. Speaking of inches, last week we saw Mississippi State had 4 inches twice and couldn't stick it in the end zone. That's about how close it was last week for the Bulldogs.
A little too close for Nick Saban's liking right now.
Three tight ends in the game. Julio Jones now comes in motion. That handoff to Richardson, that time downhill all the way.
You see, and maybe got coached up once the offensive unit went to the sideline. Look, don't try to make a guy miss you. You bring the wood to him. And, you know, maybe you bounce off a tackle or so, but you can't stop and try to make a guy miss right there. You see Trent Richardson, those shoulder, the pad level forward. He's looking for the contact.
Third down and 7. You throw here or are you just trying to not make a mistake?
You got enough room. You got a quarterback that's playing fine. I'd have no problem throwing a pass here.
That's what they'll do. Over the middle, wide open, tight end, first down, Colin Peak. Out to the 27-yard line.
What excellent throw right over the linebackers in zone coverage. You got the tight end working in the middle of the field. Watch the eyes right here after the play fake. Right there, just going to hold the linebackers, giving the room to squeeze one into your tight end. And credit Colin Peak for a nice grab. He got off to a slow start against Arkansas. Had a couple of drops early in the game, but he's right in rhythm and right in stride here early for Alabama.
His 9th catch of the year. McElroy will throw it again. Going for it all, looking for the speedster Mays. It's incomplete, but a hole perhaps in the backfield around the 20-yard line. I think James Carpenter grabbed a jersey.
Well, the big fellow's been playing some solid football for Alabama offensively and sliding into that left tackle position vacated by Andre Smith. The first round pick of the Bengals
holding
this year.
On the offense, the 77. The penalty is 10 yards to the previous spot. Repeat first down.
He played in junior college at Coffeyville Community College, and you'll see right here the nice coverage down the field on the part of Randall Burton. He's subbing in today for Paul Wolford, who's the starter for Kentucky there, but he's been stride for stride with Alabama receivers throughout this first half.
Coaches say Burton's got a great upside, a sophomore in LaGrange, Georgia. Hand off Richardson, looking to make some guys miss, but blue jersey seem to be getting all over the football. Winston Guy, the safety, coming up to make the play. For Alabama basketball fans, get down to Orlando, Florida, November 26th through the 29th to watch your Crimson Tide compete in the Old Spice Classic at the Disney Wide World of Sports Complex. For tickets and travel, visit oldspiceclassic.com.
Disney Sports Complex, impressive place to watch sporting events.
Mark Ingram in a tailback. He'll get the handoff. Ingram out to the 30. Still on his feet to the 34-yard line. Burton and Winston Guy both had a chance to bring him down, but Ingram picks up an extra 4 yards and makes it a respectable third down.
Just no secret to what Alabama's going to do. They'll tell you they're running the football. Long yardage situation on second down, and We talked about being gap sound. You slide just inside. They're going to make you pay with a nice block. You miss tackles. Mark Ingram, Trent Richardson, they make you pay with long runs.
Third down and three. McElroy to throw. Slant over the middle. Julio Jones makes the catch. He was covered by Travard Lindley, who was all over him. How Jones held on to that is beyond me.
Well, it was a well-thrown football. That's how he held on to it, away from the defender. He's just going to get inside position on a slant route. And with that big body, it doesn't have to be perfect, but he's just squeezed in enough before Travard Lindley arrives. Well, that's why I like big receivers like that. 6 foot four, 211. You throw it around him, make you look like a superstar, Dave.
Who was your big guy at Houston?
Didn't really have the big ones. We had some small guys that could move a little bit, though.
McElroy. Another pass and catch. This time it's Darius Hanks. Now McElroy's getting it cranked up. Winston Guyer finally drags down Darius Hanks, the junior out of Norcross, Georgia.
Well, this is where you got to be careful if you're Kentucky and defensive coordinator Steve Brown. Alabama finding a rhythm offensively. Zone coverage, and he reads it out. Just going to throw it right over the outstretched hands of the linebacker to that side, and as well, or excuse me, the safety, nickel safety in that situation, and the safety high on top. And they squeeze one right in there. Alabama now on the move.
Going up top again in the end zone. Incomplete. Looking for Marquise Mays. Travard Lindley on the coverage. That'll bring up a second down and 10.
Hey, you know, it's kind of one of those small wins right now in the favor of Alabama. You had them backed up. You had almost a safety take place. You had penalties against the Crimson Tide. And now look where they are. Plus yardage situation at your 30-yard line. Boy, this is tough for Kentucky right now.
McElroy, 3 out of 4 on this drive. The pistol formation. It's Ingram. He will get it down to the 27-yard line.
67% on the season and just under 1,000 yards. Having a great season.
McElroy. Another strike. Wide open in the middle of the field. It's Earl Alexander down to the 6-yard line. Tripped up by Matt Lentz. And it will be first and goal, Crimson Tide.
Boy, this is a drive that could turn this entire football game in favor of Alabama. You had them backed up. Now they're in first down and goal to goal. Greg McElroy seemed to have found his rhythm. We talked about him at one point. He was 2 for 7 for 0 yards. He's been dynamite ever since.
The shovel pass to Ingram. He's tripped up at the 4. Lentz with another tackle.
Well, this is where you play bend but don't break if you're Kentucky defensively. Those small wins that I always talk about that take place during the course of a football game where you allowed all this yardage. Now turn them away or just allow a field goal attempt on fourth down. But you got to come up big here 2 more times defensively.
Couple of tight ends in the game for Alabama. Here's Ingram, met at the line of scrimmage. It'll be third and goal.
There's no secret. They've shown the motion with Julio Jones to block out the backside, to allow penetration from the backside, and then they just run the football. And Calvin Harrison makes a nice tackle. He and Quinn Evans, the defensive tackle.
You still running here on third and goal?
One of the better running teams in the entire nation. Two pretty good running backs. I have no problem handing it off to Mark Ingram one more time.
They will throw it, looking for the tight end. Colin Peake, touchdown, Alabama. What a drive for Alabama. They were backed up at the 2-inch line. and march it the distance for the touchdown.
It's just a nice little out route by Colin Peake. The defender's outside, so you're thinking he's got the leverage. You've got a safety matched against a tight end. You think you have the advantage there. Yet still, Colin Peake still comes up with a touchdown reception.
Point after, up and good by Lee Tiffin. Greg McElroy, you could almost say that was his drive. 6 out of 7. 83 yards on the drive for the quarterback out of South Lake, Texas. Colin Peake with the touchdown reception, his first as a member with the Crimson Tide. McElroy's 8th touchdown strike of the year. Beautiful day in Lexington, Kentucky. Our SEC Network Game of the Week presented by Wrangler. Alabama just struck for their 2nd touchdown. 14-6 is our score. 40 seconds to go, and what a drive by the Crimson Tide.
Well, that young man right there leading the way, Greg McElroy. Excellent job throwing the football. 6 of 7 on that drive, 85 yards, and capping it off with a touchdown throw.
He was, as you mentioned, at one point, 2 out of 7, 3 out of 8.
He fixed that in a hurry, didn't he?
He's now 8 out of 14 for 85 yards.
And there's a pretty significant wind here. You see him having trouble keeping the football on the tee. And that might have had a lot to do with a slow start that Greg McElroy had. He was working into the wind in the first quarter, gets the wind behind him, and that was one heck of a drive they just put together.
Ground ball. Sam Maxwell will pick it up at the 30-yard line, and he'll take it to the 40, so pretty good field position for the Wildcats with just 35 seconds to go. Well, coming up on the Cellular South halftime report, we will talk and break down the game of A.J. Green. Perhaps nobody better in the conference right now than A.J. Auburn, Tennessee tonight on ESPN. Big test for the Auburn Tigers trying to go 5-0. And, of course, Michigan, Michigan State going at it in Big Ten football. It's all coming up with just 35 seconds off our game clock.
Looking forward to seeing that Auburn-Tennessee game. That's going to be a good football game.
See how Monty Kiffin and that Tennessee defense handles the running attack of Auburn. Here's Derek Lott. Lost the football. Picked up out of the midair by Courtney Upshaw. He can take it to the house, and he will. Touchdown, Alabama.
What makes the play for Alabama is going to be Rolando McClain, the superstar linebacker in the middle of that defense, comes, circles back, and is able to get a hand on the football, pops it right out, and into the hands of Courtney Upshaw, who goes the distance.
Courtney, one of those guys that Nick Saban leaning on to pick up some of the slack left by the injured Dante Hightower. Point after is up, and it is good. Wow, 2 touchdowns in a span of 19 seconds. Well, and that last play by Courtney Upshaw will be our good hands play of the day, brought to you by Allstate.
How about this? Watch the work of Rolando McClain, number 25, right here. Going to make the tackle. Not only am I going to make it, I'm going to pop the football out with my right hand. It falls right into the hands of Courtney Upshaw, and he's got a nice escort to the end zone.
Boy,
look at that. That is just a nice football play right there.
Rolando McClain, the All-American, making an All-American type play. And the recipient was Courtney Upshaw. But Andre, let me ask you this. What kind of backbreaker is that for Kentucky?
Well, it hurts because you've given up the long drive, and that in itself was defeating, and that hurts, and it's tough to overcome. But you come back the very first play and have one go for a touchdown against your offense. Now you just, it's one play at a time. You're going to get the ball first in the second half. Task right now, Dave, is to not give up any more points going into the locker room.
This kick a little bit better. Into the end zone and out of the end zone. So Kentucky will have it at the 20-yard line. 21 seconds to go before intermission. Alabama's offense went, they'll officially mark it 97 yards on that previous touchdown drive. But remember, they were backed up to like literally the 2-inch line.
Yeah.
So, I mean, they went the entire football field, and that in itself, as you mentioned, has got to be deflating.
A couple of half the distance to the goal.
penalties. They couldn't get any further back than they were, and all of a sudden they drive it right down the field.
And handoff goes to Alphonso Smith. And that should do it for the first half. And, well, the first quarter and a half, not so good for the third-ranked team in the country, but the last 7 minutes of the second quarter, dominated by Alabama, and they will take a 21-6 lead into the locker room as we have completed one half of play here in Lexington, Kentucky. Time for us to check in with Kara.
Coach, one play can change a game. What was going through your mind as you saw Courtney Upshaw streaming for the end zone?
Well, you know, we struggled on offense with field position, and we were against the wind in the first quarter. So we really wanted to throw the ball against these guys. So the last drive was really the thing that I think was the difference. And it was great that the defense got another turnover. But we need to continue to play. This team's playing good, and we're going to have to change their mindset and work hard in the second half.
Greg McElroy looked very Greg McElroy on that last drive. What changed for him as the half went on?
Well, I just think we haven't had an opportunity to throw it. I think we were throwing it kind of into the wind, and ball was floating and sailing a little bit on him in the first quarter. So definitely goes better in that direction. So, you know, hopefully we'll be able to keep spreading them out and keep throwing the ball effectively.
Coach, thank you so much.
All right, thank you.
Dave, it is pretty windy down here. I can definitely verify that. And you saw the difference it made for Alabama on their scoring drive.
It absolutely did.
I told you, well, it's going to be that's a tight football game. Well, 21-6 in favor of the Tide with those 61 yards.
Here's Derek Locke, a huge block. Springs Locke out over the 40. Let's see where they'll spot it at the 46-yard line. Lee Tiffin bumps him out of bounds. Let's go downstairs, check in with Kara.
Well, I don't know how Andre Ware snuck into Kentucky's locker room at the half, but that was Coach Brooks's message, Andre. That play, the fumble recovery score, fluky. They need to score first, score now, make it a one-score game, and get back on the board and get back in it. I asked Coach Brooks if the guys were optimistic, and he kind of threw up his hands, and I looked at him and I said, are you? And he gave me a resolved yes.
I don't think you have to worry about Coach Brooks. Or Derek Locke, for that matter, inside the 40 to the 36-yard line. Johnson brings him down, but a flag at the 40-yard line. Was that a late hit against Kentucky?
Not sure.
Yep. Be another personal foul. I mean, you're continuing to hurt your ball club, and it's penalties that are taking place behind the football. Derek Locke's already out and running and picked up a first down.
Well, Kentucky's had a couple of personal fouls in this game, and they have both been costly. This one will move it back into.
Well, one led directly to Mark Ingram's 11-yard touchdown run. And then now you've got momentum right out of halftime, and you're just kind of killing it with penalties.
Ball back into Kentucky territory at the 49. Hartline throwing over the middle. Picked off. Rolando McClain, the All-American. McClain to the 40 and dropped right there. Hartline hit him right in the numbers. It's almost like he didn't see him, but how do you not see 25 at 6'4", 260 pounds?
Well, we talked to Kirby Smart, the defensive coordinator, earlier this week, and he said, we have to locate and know where number 18 is at all times. He's trying to go to Randall Cobb right here on a nice crossing route. And they know where he is. You see about four white jerseys in that area. In the area of Randall Cobb, they make Mark Hartline pay the price.
Second interception of the day for Hartline. His fifth of the season. McElroy has time in the pocket, dumps it down to Ingram. He gets hit hard from behind to the 32-yard line. Ricky Lumpkin came in to make that stop, but Mark Ingram, they love him out of the backfield. That's his 15th catch of the year. Leads the team in receptions.
He is a fabulous player, and he's been doing it all season. I mean, he was the SEC Player of the Week, after the game against Virginia Tech. He's been solid, came into this game averaging 5.7 yards a carry and leading the team in receptions. Here's Ingram.
There he goes. Touchdown, Alabama.
Ingram on the carry. Touchdown, Alabama.
Oh, what a patient runner. He just kind of hid behind those big offensive linemen until he found a nice crease. And in it, the explosion to the end zone, Dave.
32 yards. Tiffin's point after is good. Mark Ingram. Busted onto the scene last year as a true freshman. Continues to dominate. Oh, is he a shifty, powerful back. 28-6 tied. There's a guy that'll hit you and take your lunch money.
He just dare you to say something about it.
Right. Here goes Randall Cobb. Ooh, what a big hit at the 16-yard line. Alabama has put together some impressive short strike scoring opportunities.
Yeah, it starts with the interception by Rolando McClain. Big time All-SEC linebacker setting up Mark Ingram. And that's a sign of a good running back. Patience on the inside and then the explosion to the end zone.
Andre, there were 7 minutes and 30 seconds left in the second quarter. Alabama's at the inch line. And it was 7-6. Cobb in that quarterback throws and dropped. T.C. Drake right in the breadbasket.
Boy, and you talk about self-inflicted wounds. You're talking Kentucky right here. They show the Wildcat formation, fake the run to hold the linebackers, and that's about as well as you can throw it, Dave. T.C. Drake just put it on the ground.
Hartline back in the shotgun formation. Randall Cobb, 10 touches today. Cobb did a nice job at quarterback last year when he was called to duty. Here's Hartline, hits Derek Locke out to the 33-yard line. Justin Woodall brings him down.
You know, if it's not for the mistakes, and you say, well, you know, the mistakes are there. Yeah, they're part of the game, but Kentucky would be right in this football game. An easy score on the first drive. The fumble and return for a touchdown by Courtney Upshaw. Interception led to another touchdown run by Mark Ingram.
You got to quit hurting yourself if you can touch.
There's Locke trying to student body right. Nothing happening. Thank you very much, Rob. Here, it's just been all Alabama. The last 9 minutes of this game have been owned by the Crimson Tide. Hartline over the middle, batted in the air. Picked off. Eric Anders, who already has a sack this afternoon, now comes up with his first interception.
Rolando McClain is about as smart a football player as there is on the defensive side of the football. He realized that he wasn't going to be able to pick this baby off. So what does he do? Tip it up in the air so it stays in the air longer. Check out number 25 right there in the middle of your screen. Ball's off the chest of the tight end. He comes in, tips it, and now it allows for Eric Anders to come up with the interception. That is a smart play, my friend.
So Alabama at it again. Here's the tight end, Colin Peake. He will step out of bounds at the 34-yard line. Andre, we talked about who was going to step up in that linebacker position for the departed Dante Hightower, who was injured last week.
His best friend. His best friend, and they are. When we were down in Alabama 2 weeks ago, you wouldn't see one without the other. I mean, they were always around each other, best of friends on the field. They're always talking things over, but he has elevated his game in the absence of Dante Hightower.
And the guys around him, Upshaw, Anders, Reamer, have all made plays today. And off left side. Here goes Ingram down to the 20-yard line. First down, Alabama. Ingram closing in on 100 yards now. I guess he's up around 90. 90 on the button.
Well, the thing you got to worry about now for Kentucky, you got to get your kids to continue to play for 60 minutes. But let's go back and take a look at this play by Rolando McClain. I'm in amazement. Right there, number 25 in the middle of your screen. Football's going to go off the chest of the tight end, and watch his reaction to it. He can't intercept it. It's in the air. Tips it up. Now it allows for Eric Anders to make the interception. Excellent football play.
That was kind of a basketball move too. And this man right here now, he thinks
he's a hooper.
Yeah, he says, you know, if you ask him what's your better sport, he'd tell you basketball. He says he's the best player on the team. He did a little tip drill right there.
Didn't start playing football until his seventh grade year.
Ingram takes it down to the 16-yard line. It's a shame Dante got hurt for a lot of reasons. But Rolando McClain was talking about Dante. We asked him who the second best player was, and he said Dante's making some strides to be number two on the team. But looks like Dante will have to take a little breather from hoops for a while to get that knee situated. He had surgery on Tuesday, by the way. And of course, he's already started his rehab.
They get together and play a little two-on-two. Marquise Mays is his partner. He was a pretty good guard at Tarrant High School in Birmingham, Alabama himself.
All day to throw long left, and he'll be dropped at the 18-yard line by DeQuinn Evans.
It's okay. It's okay for this reason, because you don't try to force something and turn the football over. We saw Mark Hartline pay the price early. Excuse me, Mike Hartline early in this game pay the price by trying to force a ball back over the middle, which led to an interception.
You get another chance. It's only third down. McElroy got off to a slow start, 2 out of 7. He's now 10 of 16 for 105 yards. McElroy hit, looking for Ingram. It's incomplete. That'll bring up fourth down, and here comes the field goal unit for Alabama. That pressure came from Corey Peters, a senior out of Louisville, Kentucky. His third pressure today on McElroy.
Well, I asked Steve Brown, who's your best inside pass rusher, and he didn't hesitate. Corey Peters from the inside, a returning starter from a year ago. He owns 8 sacks to his credit, and of course, in his career here at Kentucky.
36-yard attempt on the way from Lee Tiffin. The 8 out of 10 this year. In the field goal department, you can make him 9 out of 11 as he connects. That'll make it 31-6, Alabama. 10:18 to go in the third quarter. The tie, the rope. And welcome back to our Wrangler SEC Game of the Week right here on the SEC Network. Dave Neal, Andre Ware, Karen Capuano, glad to be with us. Alabama leading Kentucky 31-6, 10:18 to go. In the third quarter, Lee Tiffin, after a 36-yard field goal, will kick it away for the tie. Into that 20-mile-an-hour wind. Chance for Randall Cobb to field it. The sophomore out of Alcoa, Tennessee, out to the 45-yard line.
I have my eyes on that one, that's for sure.
Here's Derek Locke into Alabama territory. Give him 9 on the play.
Well, there's a guy. You talk about Randall Cobb, Derek Locke, two guys that are still in this game fighting, trying to claw and scratch and get Kentucky back, somewhat back in this game. And there's a lot of time left. And a lot of things can happen in a football game, Dave.
Give him the first down. Hartline. That pass incomplete behind his intended target, Chris Matthews.
Well, you see your quarterback scrambling around as receivers down the field. You got to find a way to get some separation from the guy that has you man to man. Redirect somehow, some way, get open for the quarterback. And then nobody for Kentucky, that receiving corps, really made any adjustments to find anywhere for Mike Hartline to go with the football.
Here comes pressure. Kentucky picks it up. Here's Kyle trying to make a play, and he does! Touchdown, Kentucky! He beat Javier Arenas. And Randall Cobb, the playmaker, makes another one in his young career.
Boy, excellent play. I tell you what, this is absolutely the way you do it as a receiver. He doesn't give away the fact that the ball is already thrown and in the air. You see Javier Arenas right there. Great coverage, great position. It's a little shove, but you know what? It didn't get called. But I'll tell you what, he throws those hands up at the last second to come away with the football.
Cobb will stay in and be the holder on the extra point, which is good from Lonis Sieber. So Kentucky needed something to go their way, and Randall Cobb makes Alabama pay. Hartline with a good play, letting his guy go up and get it. Touchdown Kentucky, back in a moment. Look at the picturesque blue skies over the library here at the University of Kentucky, a building that Andre and I will never see the inside of. We hear it's really nice in there, and there's a lot of books. That's what we hear.
Hey, I hung out at the library a little bit when I was in college. A little bit.
Just enough, right? Just enough. Well, Alabama gave up the touchdown to Kentucky. A little bit of a spark for the Big Blue. They needed it.
Needed something positive to happen for this football team. It indeed happened there. Big time throw from Mike Hartline.
Yeah, talk about somebody who needed something positive to happen. It's Hartline with three interceptions today. And you know what? They let him throw downfield. It's the first time he's really gone downfield today.
They caught him in a blitz situation, trying to come after him, and had one-on-one coverage on the outside, and he went to his playmaker.
Craig McIntosh will pick it away. And here is Javier Arenas. Already with a 53-yard kickoff return today. Arenas tackled at the 24-yard line.
Well, let's go back and take a look at this. This touchdown reception by Randall Cobb, and he's matched against Javier Arenas, and he's in great coverage. You're going to see him right there, just a little bit of a bump to get the separation you need. And I always say, Dave, it's not speeding until you get pulled over.
Is that what you always say? Remind me not to ride with you.
You can go as fast as you want, my friend. Until you get pulled over.
Out of the shotgun, McElroy with 9:28 to go in the third. It's Colin Peak, the tight end. Let's take a look at our game summary brought to you by Woodmen of the World Life Insurance Society of Omaha, Nebraska. And a sluggish first quarter for Alabama. Time of possession owned by Kentucky, but they could never take the lead. A couple of field goals, and then, well, the roof caved in. If you're Kentucky, as Alabama took control of this one.
Well, the last line right there tells the story. The turnovers, 4 for Kentucky, 0 for Alabama.
And I think that was preached to us over and over yesterday by the Kentucky staff. We can't turn it over. We have no chance if we do. Well, we've turned it over 4 times. Here's a look at those turnovers.
And you'll see the interception here. Mike Hartline throwing back in the middle of the field. Right here, then the fumble. Excellent play again by Rolando McClain. You see him in again on a turnover with an interception of his own. He'll make a play or be part of this one as he tips the football back in the air to Eric Anders. 4 turnovers for Kentucky.
And off to the freshman, Trent Richardson, out of Pensacola, Florida. Trent, coaches said, just came ready to play.
Yeah.
as a true freshman out of Pensacola. And, you know, you see that more and more, Andre. Guys out of high school are not only big enough and strong enough, but they're able to adapt to the college game. And you didn't see that 15 years ago.
Well, he came, talking to the coaching staff, he came with a mentality that he was going to be ready to play, as you mentioned. He spent some time with their running back coach, Burton Burns, in the summer to really learn the playbook and find out exactly how and the way they want to do things offensively at Alabama.
The play fake to Richardson. McElroy steps up, dumps it off to Trent. Trent makes a stutter step left, but a good open field tackle from Micah Johnson, middle linebacker for Kentucky. Time for us to recognize a couple of stalwarts in the classroom. Greg McElroy from Alabama and Corey Peters from Kentucky as our SEC Network Scholar Athlete to the game. ESPN Regional Television will contribute $1,000 to Alabama and Kentucky's General Scholarship Fund on their behalf. Congratulations to both of those guys. Greg McElroy graduated in just 3 years.
Smart, smart player. Knows this offense in and out. It shows up on the field.
And off to Richardson. Richardson had an electrifying 52-yard touchdown run last week against Arkansas when he broke five tackles.
Well, we talk about Mark Ingram so much, but he's not a bad guy to put in and spell Mark Ingram. Almost seven and a half yards a carry for the season and four touchdown runs to go along with it. Not bad for your freshman year, is it?
No. Well, you know, he had a 419-yard game in high school running the football.
Ooh-wee.
Here's that pistol formation. And here's Trent Richardson on second down.
Richardson on the carry.
On that play, the middle of that line. Making the stop, Calvin Harrison coming up from the safety spot to lead the charge for Kentucky.
You know what I like about Trent Richardson most is that there really isn't a whole lot of wasted movement. When he sees it, it's just like Mark Ingram. I mean, it is full throttle and full steam ahead. You saw the one instance down around the goal line where it almost cost him a safety where he tried to make a guy miss. Usually, he's delivering the punch, though. He came right back, learned from that. And the second time he got the football down there, it was pad level low and running.
McElroy. It's Colin Peake, the tight end. Shoves one defender aside and picks up the first down to the 32-yard line. It's our SEC Network Game of the Week from Commonwealth Stadium in Lexington, Kentucky. Dave Neal, Kara Capiano, and Andre Ware. Look at Mark Ingram's numbers today. 11 rushes, 94 yards, couple of touchdowns. Randall Cobb, 13 touches, 174 yards. First and 10, Alabama. That'll bring up a second down as Trent Richardson getting a lot of the work here in the third quarter. Well, Andre, this is you've made the analogy. This is a snake that'll let you get close, and as soon as you get close enough, boom, they bite and they attack. We've talked about Alabama perhaps being the best team in the country maybe at this point. What are you taking away from three quarters of football here?
Well, they're so good in all three phases of the game, offensively, defensively, and as well on special teams. That's why I think they're the best football team in the country.
McElroy over the middle looking for Richardson. That's incomplete. That'll bring up a third down situation. What is it about this Alabama team that you like so much?
Well, you know, they stick to the plan. They have a game plan coming into the football game, a solid play at quarterback from Greg McElroy. He's not a game manager. He can change the game right at a snap of a finger. Two really dynamic running backs that are of similar style and a big physical offensive line. So they will wear you down. They don't make mistakes. There's not a turnover in the football game. They don't allow the quarterback to get touched. Only four sacks on the season. It's a great, great football team from top to bottom.
Here's Upchurch off the right side. He'll pick up the first down.
You know, Dave, and I say all that, and you forget how good they are defensively. Second in the country. and maybe the best, one of the best players in the country as well, in Rolando McClain.
And we might have another few yards added on to this one, as it looked like Calvin Harrison came up and put a late hit on Upchurch when he stepped out of bounds.
After the play was over, personal foul on the defense, number 33.
Well, you'll hear me say all the time, coaches can live with penalties. Get their effort penalties. It's the bonehead penalties that drive coaches crazy, like that right there. Unnecessary, and there's been a couple of personal fouls throughout this ball game that have really, really cost Kentucky field position and put. You don't need to add any energy to this Alabama football team. They don't need it. They're good enough already.
A toss to Trent Richardson. Ooh, big hit at the 8-yard line. Sam Maxwell, 250-pound senior out of Hartwell, Georgia, made a pretty good lick on the true freshman.
Man, big Sam, he's been suffering from turf toe, but he didn't show any effects of it right here. You'll see him right here, Trent Richardson, trying to get the corner, but that is how you tackle, my friend, right there. Leading with the pads. Bringing the rest of it and making sure you wrap up.
12th play of this drive.
Demoralizing.
McElroy, the throw over the middle, looking for Jones. Batted in the air. And Sam Maxwell, who Steve Brown, the defensive coordinator, told us yesterday, asked him, give me a little something on Sam. And he says he's got a little bit of everything you want in a linebacker.
Yeah, he played a big role against Louisville early in the season. Had an interception in the fourth quarter that kind of seal the deal for Kentucky, but right there, just getting a hand on the football. They're trying to go to Julio Jones down close, big frame, get to the get to your big time receiver. And now they got him matched against Randall Burton out here wide left.
To the corner, touchdown Alabama, Darius Hanks. His first touchdown reception. He beat Martavius Nellums to the corner of the end zone.
He gets so carried away and concerned about where Julio Jones is, and you forget all the other playmakers that they have here. It's what we refer to as a smash route. You get a little underneath route at 6 yards and then a corner route over the top. And if it's timed perfectly, the defensive back is defenseless. Martavius just a little bit late in coverage.
So Hanks with a couple of catches today, the junior out of Norcross, Georgia, with his first touchdown reception, in Alabama has opened up this 25-point advantage with 3:45 to go in the third. He has brought some excitement back to this program. It's unheard of what's going on over at Memorial Coliseum. There's Derek Locke out to the 35-yard line. As we look at his resume, I mean, it is somewhat unmatched. I mean, few guys have had the success he's had wherever he's been, and he's won 76% of his games, which is third highest among active coaches. And he delivered pizzas, he brought out hot chocolate, he signed autographs, and guess what he did last night with his son, Andre?
What's that?
He brought a tent and camped out with the guys.
Oh, how about that? How about that?
Said his wife was out of town. What the heck?
He knows how to do it. Get those fans all excited, get them on your side. Sweet.
Here's Hartline on first down and 10. Being chased down. And he'll step out of bounds at the 38-yard line. Courtney Upshaw runs him out of bounds. Hot chocolate.
Six veteran players, six newcomers, and we'll try to mix and blend that talent together.
Derek Locke chased down by Rolando McClain. One more final thought about the basketball team. Patrick Patterson, I'm telling you, I'm calling it right now. Remember this, he'll be the SEC player of the year.
Oh, going out on a limb, big fella.
You know what, he's re-energized. He's got some talent around him. Patrick Patterson is going to be a monster this year. I'm just calling it right now.
Be all eyes.
I'll call you. Trust me, I'll text you and let you know how Patrick's doing. See if Kentucky picks up the first down. I believe they did. They got it to the 41-yard line. Monsell Allen tripped up by Javier Arenas.
Conversion down three.
Thank you, Rob. That pass caught by Kyrus Langster. Yeah, C.J. Spiller's a guy like Randall Cobb in a way. You just got to get him the football any way you possibly can. As you look at the ACC teams in the top 25, Georgia Tech back in the mix. Miami fell down from 9th to 17th, but Virginia Tech hanging in there. You know, I think they learned a lot about their team in that opening loss to this Alabama club.
And I disagree with the pollsters. I mean, it's a tough night to go into Blacksburg and play Virginia Tech if you're Miami. You drop from 9th to 17th in the driving range. It was, I mean, kind of unfair, in my opinion, to drop that far down. They're a much better team than the 17th ranked team in the country. We'll get a chance to see that tonight, though.
Yes, we will.
Number 8 ranked Oklahoma.
Without Sam Bradford, by the way. That decision made by Bob Stoops, along with Sam this week, that he's just not ready, so Sam Bradford won't even dress out tonight for the Sooners. Block inside the 40 to the 38, brought down by Corey Reamer, who has 6 tackles today. But I'm looking over here at my spotter, Kim Anderson, keeps track of defensive numbers for me, and I'm looking at Rolando McClain's numbers. It is off the charts good, and we still have a quarter of football left. 1 pressure, a forced fumble, an interception, a pass broken up, and 10 total tackles.
I think he stepped his game up in the absence of his buddy Dante Hightower. Took it on his shoulders, and he is delivering.
Like some movement. I haven't called Terrence Cody's name much. Big man in the middle today for Alabama. Nose tackle.
Prior to the snap, false start on the offense, number 75. 5-yard penalty remains, second down.
You know, we talked to Coach Saban about Rolando McClain a couple weeks ago, and he paid him one of the highest compliments I think you can pay a player. He said he thinks like me. And you know, he's one of the brightest coaches in all of college football, national championship. And a coach tells you that, and especially on the defensive side of the football, it's a pretty good compliment.
Second down and 10 for the Wildcats. Hartline going up top. Caught on the far side. Chris Matthews went up and got it. They'll say he's out of bounds.
Well, the coaches are waiting on Chris Matthews. He has a boatload of talent and really waiting for him to step up. Mentioned he was a junior college All-American last year. But right here, go up, get it at its highest point. Looks like the right foot might have come down inbounds. Look at, right here at the top of the. Go up. Just out. Just out and on the line. Good call by the official.
Side judge, Bobby Morello, right on top of it. Third and 10 Wildcats. Pass over the middle to Cobb. He's going to have to make a couple of guys miss to get the first down. I'll tell you what, Alabama may have swung him to the first down marker.
Yeah. We've seen some pretty good football players today. We just talked about Rolando McClain on the defensive side of it. Randall Cobb might be one of the better players that I've ever laid eyes on. I mean, he can do it all. And from a lot of different positions, he is just a football player, period.
First and 10.
Randall Cobb is, just to put it plainly, he's just a baller.
I'd go to war with him.
Yeah. Here's Locke. Derek Locke ran into his own man.
Aaron Locke on the carry for UK.
Tried to bust it to the outside and get the corner of the end zone, but ran into his own guy.
Big time center in the middle, going to pull around here and get a good block for him, and now it's just Derek Locke. Number 72, Zip Duncan down the field. If he doesn't run into Zip, he may be dancing in the end zone.
Here's Locke again. Makes a man miss. Yanked down at the 13-yard line by Javier Arenas, who I think is an underrated corner. We talk about his special teams play, but he does so much more for this club. But Kentucky's on the move right now. They're now 25. They need a lot of points in a short amount of time. Third-ranked Alabama, 38 points on the board through 3 quarters, but Kentucky driving. Their 11th play of this drive coming up right here on second down and 6.
Well, Alabama's showing blitz.
They fall back, 4-man rush over the middle. Looking for Matthews, incomplete. He nearly went up and made a heck of a play. Woodall and Jackson on the coverage.
Dangerous pass over the middle with Kareem Jackson and Justin Woodall. basically in double coverage of Chris Matthews. You're going to see the pressure here. They back out of the blitz. And Hartline feels the pressure of Eric Anders. Floats one over the middle. And right there, he is very fortunate that's not another interception.
Remember, Kentucky throwing into the wind, which is a very brisk wind. Hartline dumps it near side. Montsell Allen had some running room and perhaps could have picked up the first down had he been able to turn the corner.
There's no doubt. If you you got to know where you are on the field. And if he turns that one up, he's going to get a first down. He's going to pick the first down up. They've got to go for it here. Four down territory. Definitely.
Field goals don't do much for you now. So Kentucky looking at a fourth and four from the 11. To the five. First down, Kentucky. Boy, Hartline did not want to run it.
Yeah, he took a little bit of a hesitation step there and then realized where he was on the field. Big Josh Chapman brings him down, but not before he's able to pick up the first down. You see him here still looking. Now just tuck it. At that point, you picked it up. Go ahead and slide. Don't take that unnecessary punishment.
First and goal. Here's Locke. Off right guard, gets it down to the 2 yard line.
Well, Derek Locke came in leading the SEC in all purpose yards and dual sports star when he came to Kentucky. He came to Kentucky on a track scholarship. And they tell me, you know, you hear all these times about in 40 yard dash, 4.21 on last year's pro day. That's legitimate.
He's stuffed at the line of scrimmage. Marcel Darius, the sophomore out of Huffman, Alabama, makes the play for the tide up front.
Allen's kind of more of the thumper. You got Derek Locke and Smith. Both are relatively speed backs. But they bring Marcel Allen in. He's more the thumper when they want to get physical in the running game.
Alabama will bring in some more big bodies, send out some of the guys in the secondary. This is the 16th play of this drive coming up. Third down and goal from the 2, Alfonso Smith in a tailback. Here's Smith trying to get the corner anyway.
Well, they don't call John Connor the best blocking back in the SEC for nothing. And I tell you what, he sealed the left side of this offensive formation and allowed Alfonso Smith to walk in. Watch him right here as he's just going to seal right on the left edge. Watch this block right here on Courtney Upshaw, which allows Alfonso Smith a nice little walk in to the end zone.
Seaver's point after is up and good. So Kentucky gets it back to an 18-point game with 12:52 to go. It's 38-20 to tie it out in front. Looking at historic Keeneland Racetrack here in Lexington, Kentucky, perhaps the only thing more famous than Big Blue Basketball is the horse racing that will actually get underway again October 9th. Oh, about, say, 5 miles from campus. And you know these folks will be clamoring for some of that horse racing.
Remember, the thing to do on a Saturday afternoon, horse races, and then come on over to the Kentucky Wildcat football game.
Bad way to do things.
Not a bad way to spend a Saturday, that's for sure.
Well, Kentucky just had a 16-play drive, 65 yards, and they scored a touchdown without Randall Cobb even touching the football. As the wind blows over the football off that tee one more time. We've seen that just about every time we've had a kickoff today.
It is windy.
Look at the flags. I mean, I'm surprised many of them are still up on their flag poles. It's been blowing since early this morning. The McIntosh will kick off into that wind. It's a good kick. They'll actually get down to about the 7 yard line. Here's Javier Arenas tripped up at the 25 yard line. Excellent special teams tackle by the sophomore Matt Lentz. Let's take a look at the upcoming schedule for Alabama, brought to you by Toyota, moving forward. And of course, next week, a lot of eyes will be in Oxford as Alabama heads over to meet the Rebels, coming off a tough loss.
Yeah, they want to get back to their winning ways. You look at it after that, South Carolina, Tennessee, it'll be a tough, tough finish to the season. Even down at Mississippi State, yeah, it's going to be a tough football game when you go into Starkville.
And of course, the Auburn game, which many people thought in the summer might not be as difficult as it's been, now looks like it might be another one of those challenges.
That's right.
And the pistol formation, handoff right side. That would go to Ingram. Get a couple on the play. Of course, Auburn tonight taking on Tennessee. And as you said earlier, this will be a game where we learn a lot about the Tigers.
No doubt about it. You think about something in this game. When defensively early, Kentucky's kind of stopping Ingram and Richardson, and the pile stop. They wear on you so much during the course of a game. Now all of a sudden they're falling forward by 3 yards. Even though you make that initial contact, they're falling forward for 3 yards. That big offensive line. And good up front.
McElroy to the tight end, Tyler Peake, who's been a favorite target this afternoon. And for Peake, that's his sixth catch of this game. All right, thanks, Rob. A good one in the Big Ten. Third down coming up for the Tide. Third and one. Handoff. Ingram, first down to the 41-yard line. Nellums brings him down. Just a freshman. A couple of tight ends in the game on first and 10. They'll use Ingram. It's about four on the play, brought down by Ricky Lumpkin. Time for us to head down the sidelines, check in with Kara.
Well, guys, Coach Saban's message this week is good is the enemy of great. He wants his team to avoid complacency, and we saw that in action in the third quarter. Defensive coordinator Kirby Smart furiously diagramming on his dry erase board, telling the defense, we can get him again, we can get him again. He was Mike Hartline, and sure enough, on Kentucky's next possession, McLean with the tip, Eric Anders with the interception. You saw that in action. The message is being delivered, guys.
I think that's
fabulous stuff.
Nick Saban can't stand complacency. Nor can Mark Ingram. Up over 100 yards. He takes it to the 41-yard line of Kentucky. Give him 15 on that carry. And Ingram now with 120 yards rushing today.
Well, you know, and you think about that for a second, just the play on those couple of words. Good is the enemy of great. And if you start to think that you're too good, You kind of handicap yourself as a football team from becoming great. And I actually talked to him this week and asked him, what are some of the characteristics of your national championship team and this year's Alabama football team? He says, well, when we won the national championship, we continue to get better each and every week. And that's what they're doing right now. They buy into what he's saying as well. That's going to serve them well down the road.
Here's Ingram. We'll get 3.5-4 on the carry. Micah Johnson with his sixth tackle today from his middle linebacker position. Leads the team. Now with 31 stops on the year. As you look at Ingram heading to the sidelines, getting a little fist pump from his head coach. You know he's got a horse in Mark Ingram.
He's got one that checked in as well, a young one. A young thoroughbred in Trent Richardson as well. He's had a nice game of his own. And subbing in for Mark Ingram.
Here's Richardson. Nowhere to go. Stood up at the line of scrimmage. Third down and six. 8:40. Clock moves. McElroy going up top looking for Jones. Incomplete. Right. Randall Burton on coverage.
Winston guy lucky that he doesn't get a flag thrown here. The ball's gone already, and he takes, he delivers one to Julio Jones. You'll see him right here. They're in man-to-man coverage with Randall Burton locked up. Gets a step. This one's thrown out in front. That's going to be a maybe a touchdown reception, but Winston guy gotta be careful when the ball's gone already, delivering that hit a little bit late.
P.J. Fitzgerald will punt it away. Stands at midfield. Cobb is at the 10 to return if he has a chance. Cobb will let this one go. It'll hit at the 5 and touched and down at the 4-yard line. So good job by Fitzgerald. And Kentucky backed up as they trail by 18. Some Kentucky fans still having a good time despite the fact that their club's down 18 with 8:15 to go. Wildcats backed up inside their own 5. Here's Hartline, little inside handoff. Derek Locke takes it out over the 5 to about the 8-yard line. Take a look at our Polaris ORV hardest working player of the game. And Andre, we both agreed that it would be this man, number 22, Mark Ingram.
Yeah, you know, I don't know anyone else who's worked any harder. You see him there breaking tackles, catching passes. Just when you think you got him bottled up, he'll find a way to get to the end zone. Look at this run. That's the most impressive run I think he's had the entire day.
Swing it out over the 15. Javier Arenas runs him out of bounds. Javier with 8 stops today, but there's a look at Mr. Ingram. His numbers today pretty impressive. 16 for 124. Also has a reception. It's the team leading pass catcher on the year. And when you have him at tailback, you can do a lot of things.
Yeah, you know, they would just as soon have Julio Jones become the leader in receptions on the team or someone else other than Mark Ingram.
Hartline being chased down. That ball is it picked off? They'll say no. Marquise Johnson had his hands on it and looked like he kept it above the grass from our angle. Now, of course, we are about 100 yards away.
Take a look here, and I don't know where it actually touches. It's a good call by the officials, but don't know what Mike was thinking in that instance.
I guess the official it's 5 yards away. Probably has a better look than I do, huh? Hartline scrambling. And he'll throw that out of bounds. Give us a chance to go downstairs, check in again with Kara.
Well, guys, who's luckier than Alabama offensive coordinator Jim McElwain to have that fine stable of running backs to work with? And he says he approaches each game like a basketball coach. He gives each of his guys a few looks, a few carries, a few chances, and then he likes to stay with his hot hand. Obviously, today, Mark Ingram had the hot hand, and his numbers speak for themselves.
Well, when you have a freshman behind you like Trent Richardson, he get hot a little bit faster.
You don't have time to be cool. That timeout taken by Kentucky here. Hartline with plenty of time on the play clock. Just didn't like the look.
You know, I asked Jim McElwain a couple of weeks ago when we were down at Alabama. I said, you know, who's some of the coaches that, you know, you've coached with? And he says, I don't have any pedigree. I'm one of those dogs that you just pick up at the kennel. Yeah, you go in there and get one. But he's got some pretty good players in which to hand the football off to. Roy Upchurch is back from a high ankle sprain, and he's contributing as really their back out of the backfield in third down situations. But the other two, you just pick one that day. And as he described, whoever has the hot hand is the guy that stays and gets the most touches.
Time now to take a look at our Liberty Mutual play of the game. And it was a game changer late in the second quarter.
Right here you see Rolando McClain forcing that football up into the air and Courtney Upshaw all the way to the end zone. That's the play of the game. And I think that's when it really, really changed in the favor of Alabama.
They had just gone on a 97-yard touchdown drive, and the first offensive play from Kentucky is that play of the game we just saw. They went from a 7-6 game to 21-6. And out of the timeout, looks like Justin Jeffries might have popped up out of a stance.
Prior to the snap, false start, offense number 76, 5-yard penalty. It remains third down.
The penalties continue to be the story, Dave, throughout this football game for Kentucky.
7 for 78, Andre. Kentucky came in averaging 61 yards a game in penalties, 7th in the league. Hartline going up top, going into that wind, and the pass is caught, but out of bounds. Gene McCaskill, a sophomore out of Chester, South Carolina, made the grab, but it's incomplete, and it's fourth down and 15.
Yeah, the sophomore Robbie Green as well in the ball game, getting some playing time, helped him out of bounds as well.
Hartline 13 out of 26, 139 yards and three interceptions. Lotchka punts it high in the air into the wing. Arena's fair catch at the 45-yard line. And Alabama will have it. They are in control with 7 minutes to play. Alabama with the football, leading by 18 with an even 7 minutes to go in the contest. From Lexington, Kentucky, Dave Neal, Andre Ware, Derek Capuano down on the sidelines. Slow, sluggish start for Alabama. Led 7-6 after a quarter, and then they got it together. Ingram, good open field tackle from Martavius Nellens.
Amazing the last 3 weeks for Michigan how clutch Tate Forcier has been.
Here's Ingram. Gets it to the 36-yard line. Calvin Harrison in on the tackle. Some top 25 games to keep an eye on today. Of course, later on this afternoon, tonight, USC and Cal, number 7 versus number 24. Cal just embarrassed by Oregon. And now Oklahoma, number 8, taking on 17th-ranked Miami down in Miami.
Indiana, I think, had a tough matchup last week against Michigan. They had to come from behind to Michigan had to come from behind to beat Indiana, so that won't be an easy game, or it'll be a tough one for Ohio State today.
Third down and 2 for the Tide out of the I formation. Here's Ingram. Thank you. Got that first down. Mark Crawford comes up to make the play.
Looks like he's going to get a favorable spot here. That big offensive line. That was an area of concern for a lot of people around the Alabama program. How are they going to replace, you know, three really good football players up front, Andre Smith, Antoine Caldwell, and Marlon Davis. And I tell you what, they've done a fabulous job of kind of putting that thing together and having it have this type of success. They came in, Dave, averaging 490 yards of total offense, and numbers that you're not known for at Alabama, 40 points per game. It's amazing.
A little bit shy of that first down, but James Carpenter, a junior college transfer, has really come in to help solidify that tackle spot. Departed by Andre Smith, came in from Coffeyville Community College. And how often do you hear of an offensive lineman being the team's offensive MVP? Well, that's what he was at Coffeyville last year. And he said he came to Alabama because of the challenge. He knew he was stepping into some huge shoes, and well, he wanted to show people he could play at this level after getting only one Division I scholarship offer out of high school, and that was to Iowa State.
Mm-hmm.
Quarterback sneak. And that'll be good enough for the first down, Greg McElroy. You know, we've had a chance to spend quite a bit of time with Nick Saban this season and talk to him, kind of get into that head of his and figure out how it all works. And, you know, he's a guy that is a defensive coach by trade. That's what he does. Coaches secondary. He spends most of his time at practice with the secondary. And he lets his other guys, Jim McElwain, handle the offense. He trusts his staff. And while he may be involved defensively, he surrounded himself with an unbelievable group of coaches.
But what I like what he told Kara going into halftime as well. He says, we came into this football game with the idea we wanted to throw the football. And that lets me know that he doesn't want the rest of the SEC thinking that Alabama just can play in the box. I mean, they can't, you know, once you stop them from running the football, then you pretty much got them beat. That's not this Alabama football team. And it kind of shows up in the statistics. McElroy started the game 1 of 6 for just 4 yards. Since then, in the last three quarters, he's 14 of 19, 144 yards, and 2 touchdown passes to go along
with. This is a 30-second timeout.
It's
So they, my point is they can do both.
Right.
They can run the football and pound it if they need to, and if they need to pick it up and throw it, they're certainly capable of doing that.
Well, Alabama, one of the top 10 teams, still undefeated. As you look at the other list, Florida, week off. They'll have a chance to get Tim Tebow healthy. If not, I think they're in pretty good hands with Brantley at quarterback against LSU next week. Of course, you want your big gun in at quarterback, but nonetheless, Florida with a week off to get healthy. I still think that's a team that's going to grow every week as well under Urban Meyer. I think that they haven't even come close to hitting their stride yet.
Yeah, Texas Longhorns, Colt McCoy playing some pretty good football as well. And what, Tony Pike?
Yeah,
at
Tony
Cincinnati.
Pike.
How about him?
Cincinnati, boy, have they've developed quite a reputation. On first down and 10, here's Ingram hit the line of scrimmage. And Kentucky will take a timeout. Rich Brooks has two left. Actually, now we'll have one after this timeout.
Just getting themselves back in the top 25, and they'll be out again after today's loss to Michigan State. Michigan.
Ingram left side on second down. Has a wall of blockers, and Kentucky strung it out, played it beautifully. A couple yards on the carry by Ingram. But Trevard Lindley being carted off the field in the corner of the end zone, headed back to that Kentucky locker room area. Your best player defensively, perhaps one of the best cover corners in the country, the senior. That's not a good sign.
No, it isn't. And it's an ankle injury that bothered him off for a good part of this football game. His deal today was to hold and lock down Julio Jones, and did a pretty good job while he was in the game. And Jones was held to just two receptions on the afternoon.
It's Jones in motion, but they'll run to the right side. Ingram. Kentucky put nine guys up in the box. Danny Trevathan gets credit for that stop, his seventh of the game.
Julio Jones was thrown two. We're going to track that matchup. Thrown two seven times, only two receptions, 13 yards. Bart Henley, Lindley, I'm sorry. Did a pretty good job on him early, and then the ankle injury, and he had to do it by committee. Randall Burton actually got the assignment after Lindley went off. But, we still got other playmakers on that Alabama offense.
Well, Julio, of course, missed the North Texas game with a bruised knee. Came back last week. And Julio picked up his first touchdown reception since last year, believe it or not. Snapped a 12-game streak without a touchdown last week. And the healthier he gets, the worse it is for the opposition. Let's go downstairs, check in with Kara.
Well, guys, you were talking about cornerback Trevard Lindley, and he did roll his ankle early in the third quarter. They taped it. He was uncomfortable, took him to the training room. X-rays were negative, but basically he wanted to come back out and watch from the sidelines, and his ankle stiffened up on him so bad they didn't want to put any weight on it. That's why they carted him back to the locker room.
Thank you, Kara. Let's hope that young man's all right.
They've had some playmakers emerge opposite Julio Jones, Alabama, and Marquise Mays, and Darius Hanks, as well as Mike McCoy. So now teams won't be able to just kind of roll coverage to Julio Jones. They're going to have to play the entire field, and that's going to free up Julio Jones. So watch his numbers kind of grow.
Play of game, offense, number 99. 5-yard penalty. It remains fourth down.
So back Alabama up 5 yards. This will make this a 49-yard field goal, which would match the season long of Lee Tiffin. He has the wind at his back.
38-20 lead, and Coach Saban still coaching, still pacing the sidelines.
It's a fake. Fitzgerald will take it to the 20. Fitzgerald. Run out of bounds at the 15-yard line. First down, Alabama.
Just giving the rest of the SEC a little bit to think about right there.
Is that a called fake, or is that something you think P.J. Fitzgerald
saw?
I think
it's definitely a called fake, and here's why I think it was called. They're just trying to run the clock out. You think, oh, they're trying to run the score up. If they were trying to throw it for a score, then I would agree that, yes, it's running the score up. This is basically, we're going to keep the football and make sure not give you an opportunity to score anymore and run the clock out here.
Out of the pistol formation again. Here's Ingram off the right side. Nothing doing. Boy, Kentucky's loaded up the box and making it hard for the Tide to run the football. Richardson.
Not quite sure if they were able to force him out of bounds. I think they did to stop the clock. Well, actually, no, they're going to wind it. So see, the momentum took him out. This clock's going to continue to run here. But I'm okay with that fake. And a lot of people are going to look at that and say, oh, you're running it up and rubbing it in. No, it's just to continue to keep the football and run the clock out without Kentucky having an opportunity to go down and score. And maybe, you know, an onside kick or something.
Richardson will get another chance to carry the football. Runs right into middle linebacker Micah Johnson. But what it does is keep the clock moving. Time to take a look at our Wrangler five-star player of the game, and it's got to be this man, 25, Rolando McClain. What an afternoon for the middle linebacker.
Yeah, an interception. He was in on a pass. A pass breakup. He had 10 tackles, a pressure on the quarterback, and forced a fumble. He was all over the field today, and I have no problem whatsoever awarding him as our player of the game.
He is just a stud.
And an excellent human being as well.
Yeah, good guy. Enjoyable to talk with. He's got it kind of figured out, you know, as a young guy. He kind of knows the priorities. He knows what's important. He knows that hard work gets you places. He's a great leader.
And on top of that, sometimes, you know, guys will quit listening to you if you're just on them all the time and just kind of pounding it away. He knows when to loosen up a little bit and crack a joke and just kind of, you know, ease the mood of practice, a hard practice. Or so you know, you enjoy having guys like that on your football team.
Not many players like him come around.
He's got that contagious smile too, doesn't he? He just kind of just, you know, I could see Coach Saban wanting to be hard and tough, and he just cracks that smile on and just melts him right down.
Right. Not many people can do that. Alabama will take a timeout. We'll return in just a moment. I think that look pretty much says it all for the Kentucky faithful.
It's been a tough, tough ball game.
On fourth down, Alabama will throw it to the end zone. Incomplete. Looking for Mike McCoy. It's incomplete on fourth down, so Kentucky holds, and they will get the football back with a minute 26.
Throw a fader out. I don't know if I agree with this call. Maybe run the football. The clock continues to run, and then you get the change of possession. But right here, clearly unable to come up with a football. Just run it. Run the clock out so that you don't put yourself, you know, you give people reason to really criticize you.
Well, there's some fans in front of us right now wearing blue jackets that aren't exactly wishing the folks from Alabama Merry Christmas. Wow. That pass complete to Kyrus Langster.
Has the ball, under two to go.
Thank you very much, Rob. That pass caught by Monsell Allen. That'll move the chains with under a minute to go. But, Andre, this is we talked about it from the very beginning. Alabama, a team garnering some attention. They got some first-place votes this week in the polls. How good are they? How good can they be? Your impressions after watching this one today.
I tell you, the thing that they really got to kind of dodge or avoid is injuries, and that's just a part of the game, and you kind of let the season play out. But they're as good a team as I've laid eyes on this year, and that's Florida included. So they can do it on all three phases, offense, defense, as well as special teams.
Hartline just throws it away. I just think their defense is so good when they want to be. There are some times there where teams have run the football on them and gotten some, but when it comes time to buckle down and tighten the chin strap, this is a group that I have a lot of confidence in, seeing them now 2 weeks, and you just think that when it comes to that point, they know how to stop a team.
Well, think about it from this standpoint, and this ball game, is that's what turned the tide of this football game. It was defense.
Right.
It wasn't the offense. You go down and score, and then they had some problems moving the football. But then you had the forced fumble by Rolando McClain. And then all of a sudden, right before halftime, that's when the culture of this game really took a change.
McClain with another stop for Alabama. The clock moves at 20 seconds. So this Alabama team will go to 5-0 on the year. And they have now won 18 of their last 20 football games. An impressive unit wearing the white.
I think it's just an excellent football team, and they're getting consistent quality play at the quarterback position, which was a question mark as well with John Parker Wilson leaving and graduating. And I think Greg McElroy stepped right in and has done a fine job.
Last time Nick Saban was here, he had to win on a Hail Mary pass when LSU beat Kentucky. This time a little bit more comfortable for the coach wearing the shirt and colors of Alabama.